Okay, so today I think we'll talk about gluing. So that is what I want to do is show how to describe the local structure of the moduli space near curves which are split, curves which are broken at rabe orbits. So let me begin by just recalling the setup. So we have our target y, we have our contact form, and we have our almost complex structure on r cross y. And satisfies the following three properties. So it should be r invariant j of d by ds is equal to the Rabe vector field, and j sends c to itself, and restricted to c is compatible with d lambda. So then we denote by p the set of closed orbits of r lambda, unparameterized. And now, right, so gluing is simply a statement about one fixed moduli space. So I may as well just fix once and for all gamma plus, gamma minus, and the homology class of curves that we're considering.
B is the curve, all I non-degenerate closed orbits.
Yes. It's all non-degenerate. Yeah, thank you. Non-degenerate. Yeah. So we fix this data, and then the moduli space M bar fills the set of curves like this.
Sorry, T minus is a set or element?
Gamma minus. And it's a, yeah, it's a set. Yeah. Right, so this is gamma plus, and these gamma minus. And it's, okay, so this is, each of these is a holomorphic curve mapping to r cross y, and it's considered up to translation. Each of these individual pieces is considered up to translation in the r direction, and in homology class beta. So from now on, I'll just forget about gamma plus, gamma minus, and beta. That is, I'll leave them out of the notation because we're just interested in this fixed moduli space. Okay, and then denote by m bar reg of the locus where the linearized operator is surjective. So then the theorem is that, so first, this is an open set. And near any point in it, there exists a local homeomorphism from RK cross R to the n minus k to m bar reg by sending 0 to the base point, and where n is the virtual dimension of m bar, k is number of nodes of this at this point p, and it's compatible with the stratification. That is, the left-hand side is stratified by which of these first k coordinates are zero, and the right-hand side is stratified by at which places did we resolve the node. And it's compatible with that stratification. And the compatibility with stratifications is, okay, it comes sort of trivially from the construction, but of course it's crucial to include in the actual statement, because the homeomorphism type of this only depends on whether k is zero or positive. Stratification is important data to keep track of. Yeah?
When you say node, you mean intermediate Hilbert orbits?
Yeah.
Breaking,
yeah.
And you see them as nodes in the line.
Right. So the first remark is that to establish contact homology, we need something slightly stronger than this. What we need is establish the same statement for these thickened moduli spaces m bar sub I. The addition of these sort of thickening terms in this moduli space, though, doesn't really change the argument. And so, for sake of simplicity, I just want to explain the proof of this. Moreover, we not only do we have to deal with these thickened guys, we also have to prove this submersion property. So we have to basically show that this m bar reg inside m bar j reg is cut out transversally like this. We need this to be a topological submersion. Okay, so let me not say more about this right now. It's exactly the submersion axiom in the implicit atlas definition, which I gave earlier. The point is just that, okay, both of these are really only slight extensions of the proof of this. And the other remark is that we don't need to establish any sort of compatibility results, compatibility properties between these local gluing charts. They're just local homeomorphisms. Probably if one works hard enough using gluing profiles, one can show that we get a smooth structure on this space, as the transition maps between these charts are smooth, but this is not needed for what I want to do. Yeah?
When you want to do the same thing for thickened moduli spaces, do you use something like seeing this elements of the thickened moduli space as holomorphic curves in something bigger, like in the when we do inhomogeneous Cauchy-Riemann version, or is it simply that you change slightly the analysis?
You can think of it like that. I think that in the end it's the same. You can write something as the inhomogeneous equation, or you can write something as the true holomorphic curve equation on this bigger thing. And I think the thing, when it comes down to it, the things you actually have to check are the same, no matter which perspective you use. So. Right, so the closest result in the literature to this theorem is apparently, as far as I know, this result, gluing theorem of Hutchings-Taubes, I believe in 2009, in their construction of embedded contact homology. So what they do is they prove a gluing theorem for embedded curves. Oh, embedded isn't. Is very important. They do gluing for SFT curves, basically, in R cross a three manifold. And in fact, their result is somehow more, much more involved in this statement because they have this extra thing that they do. They stick on branched covers of trivial cylinders in between the curves that they glue. And they also have this obstruction bundle gluing that happens. Somehow the techniques which go into this are, well, basically the come from the same body of work that this lies in. This sort of originates from the gauge theory literature with Taubes, Donaldson, Kronheimer. And eventually with sort of applied to holomorphic curves by Fleur and FL cubed and Hofer-Rosatsky-Zender. So I just want to show how these techniques are applied to prove this theorem in the case of contact homology. Okay, so begin with some setup. So first we have to fix our base point, which instead of calling P, I'm now going to call x0. So we fix our base point x0 in M bar reg. And what that really is a map u0 from some curve c0 to x0 hat. So this is just the domain of the map. This is the target, which is a disjoint union of a bunch of copies of R cross Y. But I'm just going to call it X hat naught. Let mu denote the index. The index of this moduli space, that is the virtual dimension. T0 will denote the dual graph of C0. So maybe I'll draw an example. So let's even take this example. So maybe this is C0, then x0 hat is the disjoint union of four copies of R cross Y, a separate copy for each of the components of the curve. And the map is considered only up to translation. So. And then T0 is the dual graph. Like this. And I'll let V of t0, this is just the set of irreducible components of c0 and e. This is the interior edges. Oh, I really mean the interior edges. So this is the intermediate rate orbits.
Have you been in your last lecture? So you ignore bobbins, yeah, it's
something. Yeah, so in the symplectization, r cross y is exact, so there won't be any bubbling.
Exactly, yes.
But one could also add bubbles. In that case, I'm not going to keep track of the bubbles in the tree, just because we don't need that stratification to in the. Yeah. So for the purposes of this argument, it really doesn't matter the genus, but yeah, assuming genus zero for now. Right. So now our goal is to construct a map, a local homeomorphism, germ of homeo from this to here. Respecting stratifications and landing in the regular locus. So this, since it's a germ of homeomorphism, that means it covers an open neighborhood of x0. And since it lands in m bar reg, that means m bar reg contains an open neighborhood of x0. In particular, m bar reg is open, since this is true for every x0. So this is what we have to show. Right. So first setup we want to do is domain stabilization. So we really want to, what's the purpose of this step? Over a neighborhood of this point x0 in the moduli space, we want to sort of fix canonical coordinates on the domain. The problem is that for this and this, these two components, they are biholomorphic with the cylinder and the plane respectively, but not canonically so. And we have to get rid of this this extra freedom, or do some gauge fixing. In order to be able to produce local parameters for the moduli space like this. So what we do is we fix some points qi and c0. And our invariant divisors di inside r cross y, such that u0 is transverse to di at qi. So I don't care whether it's transverse to di anywhere else, just at qi. Okay, such that this holds, and C0 equipped with these points is stable. Okay, so here, really, C0 is already equipped with its marking by like the positive and negative punctures. So we just have to stabilize these two guys. So it looks something like this. Di and qi. So now, since U0 is transverse to DI at QI, this property of is preserved under small deformations of the holomorphic curve. That is, over an open neighborhood of X0, you get corresponding points QI in the domains of all of those other holomorphic curves. And therefore, you've done this gauge fixing over a neighborhood. Right. So, second, we introduce the glued covertism as target. Right there. Okay, so for a gluing parameter, I'll call an element of this space a gluing parameter. We define this glued target to be obtained from X0 by truncating the ends. I'll hold it at the ends. The ends look like 0, infinity, cross y. And you truncate them to 0, the gluing parameter, cross y. Do the same thing for a negative end, and then you glue via this identification. As I've described it, it's a little bit.
But J inverse, because you want to G very close to zero.
Yeah, you're right. Yes, I forgot about this. Right. So, the way I've described it, it's not entirely accurate. So suppose we're taking this curve. So we have x0 is like four copies of r cross y. So let me just draw them as, just draw the r factor. It looks something like this. And suppose I glue all of the parameters using exactly this recipe. I get this, so this is like x0 hat, xg hat, then looks like, so I have this first piece. Second piece, I glue both of these here. I get something sort of non-Hausdorff like this. Okay, obviously I don't want a non-Hausdorff target, but there's sort of an obvious canonical way of just closing it back up to R cross Y. So XG again, so XG, of course, is again just a big disjoint union of copies of R cross Y, but somehow this particular description is the one we care about.
Because you have tree, you don't have trouble.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. If we had something more general, then we'd have to there'd be some constraint on the space of allowable gluing parameters. Right, so okay. Now it's important to keep track of the zero sections here. So for V in V, that is a for every irreducible component of the original curve, we're gonna let zero, so V inside X bar zero, X hat not denote a corresponding zero section. And we let the corresponding, and we also denote by that the corresponding zero section is ascent to X. Right, so there's some canonical zero across Y here, and we get some points here. For each component of the original curve. Okay, now finally, this is again an important point. I want to fix sections QV prime of this universal curve over the Lie moduli space of curves of genus 0 and equipped with points marked by the input-output edges and these extra marked points qi. Oh, so I already commented earlier that by choosing these divisors di, we identify the domains of all the holomorphic curves, all the points in the moduli space over a neighborhood of x0 with fibers of this map. That was somehow the purpose of adding these divisors to gauge fix the target, the domain, rather, gauge fix the domain. What I want to do now is gauge fix the target. And gauge fixing on the target uses these sections. So sections QV prime, such that when you evaluate them at C0, you land, QV lands in the corresponding irreducible component of C0. So there's one point, QV prime, in every irreducible component of C0.
So it's going to run around the show. It's not one,
Sorry.
This QV prime can be point on a show, little set of geometrical coordinate.
It is on a...
Just to fix it, the shift by R,
Right, so, what was I going to say? Right, okay, so, yeah, indeed, okay, this is sections defined in the neighborhood of C0. I mean, obviously, maybe this whole vibration doesn't have a section, but we only care about locally. Yes, and so the whole point of fixing these sections QV prime is to gauge fix the target. So we're going to now only look at maps which send QV prime to the corresponding zero section 0V. All right, so for glued maps, we gauge fix the domain via these QIs, which are essentially sort of the inverse image of DI. And we gauge fix the target via requiring the U of QV prime lie in this zero section. So really what that means is that at a point close to x0, I get a unique gluing parameter. So if you have a map close to x0, your domain is canonically identified with with one of the fibers of this universal curve, because you have these points qi from intersecting with di. And then that gives you points QV prime via this arbitrary choice of sections. And then this requirement that QV prime be mapped to the zero section tells you what the gluing parameter has to be, because this length here is exactly the G inverse. Okay, so I think this is all the gauge fixing we need to do, which is good.
I guess you could intersect DI several times, but you just follow the intersection point that used to be.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yes. Right. So. Right, so we're going to furthermore fix a trivialization of the universal curve over this. Except it's not exactly the universal curve here that I want to fix a trivialization. It's something slightly different. So I'm going to denote by m bar 0. So here I'm looking at a compactified moduli space of curves of genus 0 with m plus n marked points. But the first n marked points are in addition going to be equipped with a marking of the tangent space by C. So this is, of course, a forgetful map. And this is a principal GL1 to the n bundle. So this classifying. X classifies curves C with P1, Pn, Q1, Qm, and sigma I from C to the tangent space at Pi.
What is this bundle?
Yeah.
What is written in N subset what?
So N lower parentheses 2. Yeah, so why do I care about this curves with an extra marking here? So when you have an end, right? So if you have a map, so why do we care? So if you have a holomorphic map, say U from standard half cylinder to R cross Y asymptotic to a Rabe orbit means that U of S comma T is equal to the length of the Rabe orbit times S plus some constant gamma tilde of t, okay, plus little of 1, as s goes to infinity, where gamma prime is a parameterization of this, the Rabe orbit that's asymptotic to. Okay, but the point here now is that the coordinates on R cross Y give rise to a marking of the tangent space at the puncture by C, namely by sort of requiring that gamma tilde be sort of not rotated at all and B be zero. That is somehow, and this is the way I want to think of these curves. I want to think of C0 as equipped with a marking of the tangent space at each of the punctures. And with respect to those coordinates, I want sort of B to be 0 and gamma tilde to be not rotated. Right. So. So now we fix coordinate local trivializations of this moduli space. So fix local diffeomorphisms from J. So JV will denote C 2 times dimension of this moduli space. So for each irreducible component, so that's for each vertex, we fix a local diffeomorphism of this moduli space, where you have the points qi and you have a tangent space marking at each of the punctures. So, yes. Right. So now, okay, so I also want to fix cylindrical coordinates on x0 and c0. That is, so we fix coordinates like this for, okay, these are valid for S sufficiently large, near all the punctures, and near all punctures, such that with respect to these coordinates, we have U0 ST is asymptotic to the length of the corresponding Rabe orbit times S and gamma of T, where as S goes to infinity, and of course I mean that, right, the point here is that this coordinate B is zero and that this is not twisted. Okay, so finally, I think the last piece of setup is we have to glue the curves, glue the domain. So really these gluing parameters G lying in R greater than or equal to 0 to the E, this should be thought of as the gluing parameters for the target, not the gluing parameters for the source. So C sub G. Right, so we basically do exactly the same operation. So we truncate C0 from on each end to 0 GE inverse. And we need a factor of the length of the right orbit also. Right, this is one reason why, yeah. Right, because the trivial cylinder, right, has this factor of L in it. So if we glue the cobordism by truncating and translating by G inverse, we better glue the curve by G inverse times L inverse. Right, so what is the end identify? As before. So the picture looks like this. We have an end of C. This is C0. This is a puncture. We have another end of C0. We truncate the ends as we cut off here. And then we glue them together. So this is CG. Now, I want to right now the rotational coordinate is chosen by the, you have an asymptotic matching of these, of the two ends, since they're both asymptotic to the same ray orbit. So it's a crucial thing to do is to fix a point QE double prime in the center of each glued edge. So this QE double prime in CG exists for every E which has a positive gluing parameter. And this is needed for some gauge fixing. The problem somehow is you have, right, so what happens? There.
Can you tell me what is this QE double prime?
So
the point you fixed.
So it's the point in the middle of, in the exact middle of the neck here. Just fix. Fix such a point. The S1 coordinate doesn't matter, but just as long as you fix some way of defining it. So the right. Why do we need this? So the point is that there's a map. From. So we have these families of almost these trivializations of the moduli space of each of these components. But that somehow only tells us about curves on this stratum. We also need curves on the other strata too. So what happens if we fix a G, we get a map from this product of J's. To what? Well, it's a product over all vertices of the glued tree of m bar 0. So again, we look at the QIs which lie in the vertices which mapped there, plus the QE double primes in the edges which got collapsed, plus the punctures and they have a double marking. Not just the points, just the tangent spaces also. So this is a local diffeomorphism. Which, and this would not be true if we did not include the data of QE double prime. I mean, the dimension wouldn't even be correct. There. Yeah, somehow if we just do this, you're right, if we just do this gluing construction and look at all possible almost complex structures J, we get two extra degrees of freedom because we don't know what the marking of the tangents of the tangent space at these ends was for C0. This is some sort of tricky point.
But yeah, you need
a local diffeomorphism. No. This. Oh no. Yeah, homeomorphism would be enough. It's a smooth map. I think that's all I need. A smooth map, which is a local homeomorphism. I think that's all that's actually needed.
And in all this construction, do you ever need to have the full universal curve or full modulus, the import space at any point, or do you only need those local charts of moduli spaces of curves?
I only need the local part near the particular curve we're gluing.
You never need to know anything about the global structure of the import or universal curve.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's a gluing is a completely local statement, so it should
be. But I was asking about more generally the full story.
Yeah, so you mean for the construction of the atlas and stuff.
Yeah.
I don't need it. It's not really used there either. I mean, there's some, right, they're like, in certain setups, you might sort of be interested in the question of, this moduli space. No, you don't look at this moduli space. You ask, does this have a section? This is basically saying, is there a sort of global way of choosing asymptotic markers? I think this is not true. I think it doesn't have a section. But yes, for us, this in the setup, we don't need a section. Did I? Oh, I already flipped the boards. Great, so we've now defined, we've gauged fixed everything in the near our point. We've defined these glued cobordisms, the glued curves. So the final thing is we have to define the glued maps. So of course, first we do the pre-glued maps, UG. So what's our fixed cutoff function? Chi. And okay, so the two steps. So we first define a what I'll call a flattened map, U0 bar G from C0 to X hat 0. So what is the picture? So U, the map U approaches a trivial cylinder. So the trivial cylinder here, right? So this map is U0. This is a trivial cylinder. And I'm just going to cut off U0 to the trivial cylinder. So this is that. Oh, and in symbols, it's this. So we take U0 for, right, so capital S will denote G minus 1. So maybe I'll just write that instead. LS will denote that. Now I remember why I decided to call it S. Anyway, so this is for and then here we interpolate that is we take an exponential trivialization the sort of diffeomorphism of yeah right we take exponential coordinates near this rape orbit and just cut off. So this is for S in 1/6. Yeah, something like that. Yeah, it doesn't, I mean, yeah. Yeah, the things will happen over this neck, and this is the first thing that happens, and a bunch of things will happen. The other things that happen will happen sort of only on the part of U0G, which is a trivial cylinder, which is why we...
Is this a gamma tilde anyway?
Yeah, it's just...
How would you get fixed that gamma tilde is gamma?
Yeah, I guess, okay, but I've usually been thinking of gamma as the unparameterized orbit, so whenever it's something parameterized, I put a tilde. Right. So then we get this pre-glued map. UG from CG to X hat G is just the descent of U0G. The map agrees with this description of C0G. So now we have a map. So this gives a map. So for every, no, it's not right. This here. Right. So we get a map from for every gluing parameter. We get something. This map. So I don't know what to write here. It's of course, I can't write m bar because this map isn't holomorphic. But what we want to do is somehow correct this map to be holomorphic so that it lands in m bar. And we also want to somehow add this extra set of parameters on the left, namely r to the mu minus e, corresponding to the kernel of the linearized operator at this point. Okay, so now we're going to get into some actual analysis here. So gluing estimates. So first, I need to tell you what weighted Sobolev norms we're using. So we need some weighted Sobolev spaces of functions and maps or sections over C0. So we're going to be looking at spaces like WKP sections of the pullback of a tangent bundle of XG to CG. So we define weighted WKP delta norms given in the ends and the necks by the following. So in an end, something like this. P So basically, in the end, we just add a factor of e to the delta s to the function, or multiply the function by a factor of e to the delta s. That is the functions here decay like e to the delta s. Right, so I'm just sort of writing the contribution to the pth power of the norm over this end. And the away from the ends, it's just the usual norm. And then in the next, something like 0 to capital S cross S1. We, of course, do something similar. And now the weight is P delta times the minimum of S and capital S minus S. So in end, the weight looks like this, e to the delta S. And in the neck, the weight looks like this. This is e to the delta times the minimum of s and s minus s. So these are somehow the norms which are relevant for this problem. So here, delta is some small positive number. By small, you can say precisely what you mean by small. So specifically, delta should be less than the smallest eigenvalue of the asymptotic linearized operator of the Rabe orbit in each of the ends. And yeah, and then this Fredholm analysis is where we really need the ends, where we see the need to have ends be non-degenerate. It's one of the places. The other place is in the a priori estimate. If you have a trivial cylinder over a non-degenerate Rabe orbit, then if you take a C0, holomorphic curve which is C0 close to a trivial cylinder over a non-degenerate Rabe orbit decays exponentially toward that trivial cylinder. Exponentially meaning at least as fast as e to the minus delta s, where for any delta less than the first positive eigenvalue. This is the fundamental a priori estimates of Hofer-Rosatsky Zender. Right, but then, right, so this defines for us weighted Sobolev spaces like this over each of the glued curves C sub G. And okay, it suffices to take P equals 2 for this. For this argument, we don't need anything else. But of course, we could. I mean, everything I'm going to be saying is true for any P in this range. But
there's nowhere you need P equals 1 to impose P equals 1.
Not for this. Chris Wendell has this blog post about this, whether at any point you need to use this P equals 1. Yeah. So for this, it's really not needed. I think what is the point? Yeah, we somehow, given all the a priori estimates, which sometimes require P equals, maybe they don't never require P equals 1. Yeah. At least some ways you write them, P equals 1 seems necessary.
Yeah, I think that the conclusion of the discussion with Chris was that maybe gluing was the last remaining place where P equals 1 was needed. And if you say gluing doesn't need...
Yeah, I think it really doesn't need P equals 1. Yeah, P equals 2 should be really fine. I mean, the point is you're only dealing with curves which you've already proved your a priori estimates for. And, I mean, we can take K to be large. Yeah, I think the difference between P equals. Yeah, anyway. No, but wait, no. The issue with.
Oh, sorry, I wanted to ask K equals 1, of course. I meant.
Oh, you meant K equals 1.
Do you need sometimes P to be bigger than 2 and K equals 1?
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah. So K will be large. Right. Okay. So maybe I should summarize since we. Saying the wrong thing. So for this gluing argument, all of our curves we're sort of doing this argument after we've proved all the a priori estimates. And we know our curves are very highly differentiable, so we're going to just fix a large k. And since k is large, we can take p equals 2. If k were 1, maybe we need P larger than 2.
Actually, in the same question, do people think how this floor theory, whatever, one can find for less and less smooth symmetric manifold, like P is symmetric?
Yeah, I don't think anybody's. I mean, I don't know anything about this.
Like for P is symmetric. If you consider less and less smooth symplectics, conditional symplectic structure, mm-hmm. like PL symplectic manifolds.
Ah, PL.
Is it possible to define such thing?
I don't think anyone ever considered doing homomorphic curves in such situations over there. And Eliashberg and Mercredi are thinking about PL symplectic manifolds, but it seems that everything is complicated, even the local questions.
Yeah, I think we should talk to that.
So nonlinear. Oh, So we have this. Right, so we want to understand the moduli space of holomorphic curves near this pre-glued map. And so what we do is any such map is given by some exponential of some exponential of some vector field and an almost complex structure on the domain. Okay, but actually, we're not going to use all vector fields. So we have to preserve this condition of intersecting di at qi. So we only consider the subspace where c of qi is in the tangent space to di. And we also only consider the subspace where this sort of the same condition at qe double prime equals 0. So we have this point qe double prime. And in order to gauge fix the domain again, we have to pick, we have to specify qe double prime on, a priori specify what qe double prime is on the domains of all the curves in the moduli space near near x0. So what I'm going to say is that qe double prime is the inverse image, or sorry, the image of the of this space under the exponential map. I can just declare it to be that. That gives a local divisor. The inverse image of that under the map will be qe double prime. Okay, so you have a vector field and an almost complex structure. And from the vector field and almost complex structure, we can then ask what is del bar? And we get a section. Sorry?
What is this?
J.
On the target?
On the source, on C. We're varying. J was, I think I've erased it by now. J was this set of almost complex structures on the source. Yeah. Yeah, the almost complex structure on the target is always fixed here. So omega 0, 1. Right, so what is this? Map FG. So a vector, it takes a vector field and an almost complex structure. I'll denote by J sub Y on there. So what do we do? So exp UG C, that's the map. We take differential. Take the anti-holomorphic part with respect to this JY almost complex structure and J on the target. This is a section of over CG, not of this bundle, but rather this is in sort of sections WK minus 1 P delta sections of this part. Of omega 0, 1 CG with the JY almost complex structure and with exp UG C pullback of this tangent bundle. So to put it here, we use parallel transport on this part. We use parallel transport. And on this part, use some fixed identification map. I mean, it doesn't really matter, just some complex linear map. So a parallel transport for a J linear connection. Certainly need it, otherwise a tensor product won't make sense. So J linear connection on X hat, that is R cross Y, say R invariant J linear connection, just to be safe. And then I tensor with this just fixed identification map. It doesn't really matter what we do here, just any map which is C linear and smooth and depends smoothly on Y and is the identity for Y equals zero. Now we're not done with the definition because we also have this other component of the target. So we add, so what is this component telling us? This tells us the vertical positions of all of the images of all of these QV primes. So remember, since we did this gauge fixing, we're now interested in maps which map these QV primes to the corresponding zero sections. So we take exp UG XC of QV prime of Y. So I write it QV prime of Y because at this point in C0 and CG really depends on this almost complex structure Y. Because this QV prime was a section of the universal curve. So we have this, and then we just project to R. This is an element of R cross Y. We project to R, and we do this for all V in V. So all of the QV primes. So now with this complicated definition, our moduli space near X0, near X0, our moduli space is the union over G in. Okay, I'm writing it like this, but of course I really just mean small gluing parameters G, sort of a germ of identification of FG inverse of zero. Now this this local. This gives a local map from M bar to the space of gluing parameters. But this is not at all a canonical map. It depended on our choices of divisors and sections QV prime. Right, and so I as far as I know, all of this works for. Right, so another comment about k equals 1 versus larger k. I should apologize for screwing up this discussion the first time. This operator, it makes sense. Seems to make sense for any k at least 1 and any p between 1 and infinity. If you have k equals 1 and p 2 or smaller, or you have k equals 2 and p equal to 1, I guess we don't care about that, then sections here are not continuous, which is a little bit disconcerting. You need this, right? Because we can't do this exponential. So this only makes sense for either k equals 3, k equal 2, and p greater than 1, or k equals 1 and p greater than 2. Right. The differential of this map makes sense for any kp. And k equals 1, but yeah. And we actually, so for the gluing argument we're doing right now with just holomorphic, with just the holomorphic curve equation, we could really do it with any and any of these that we want to. It's somehow the Fredholm analysis is a bit easier with p equals 2. But when we do this, the same thing for the thickened moduli spaces, it's really important to be able to choose large k, because there's an extra term in this part of the equation, the thickening term, and it depends on the places where this exponentiated curve intersects certain divisors. And this map from the space of C to CG, given by take the inverse image under this exponentiated map of a fixed divisor, this map is of regularity class something depending on k, something like ck minus 2. So if we want this to be a nice smooth map that we can apply the inverse function theorem to and understand its zero set, we need k to be large.
And so you need k large anyway, so it's p equals 2. If you need k large anyway, so there is no point in using p greater than 2.
I guess so.
Yeah, so I mean, right. So now there are a few fundamental estimates, which I could spend a whole lecture doing the calculations for, but I'm not. So let me just write down some things which one can prove about this map. So first, estimate norm of Fg of 0. So lemma, this norm Fg of 0, that is, so if this measures how far the pre-glued map is from being holomorphic, of course using this norm, this goes to 0 as g goes to 0. Okay, maybe I will sort of prove it. Okay, first one comment about the norms. I mean, you can define like norms with like actual explicit formulas, including like trivializations of these bundles in the ends. But all that really matters is the commensurability class, the commensurability class of these norms uniform in G. So you could pick another norm which is commensurable with a commensurability constant which doesn't depend on G, and that would be fine too. The point is just to have estimates which are true for all G. And this is somehow why this, right, for any fixed G, this norm defined by this weight is commensurable with the norm defined by not doing any weight 1. But as G goes to 0, of course, they're not uniformly commensurable. Okay, so the one form part. So this guy has two parts: the one form and the 0-1 form and the vertical coordinate part. Also, the one form part of Fg of 0 is supported in this region, if you recall the definition, right, that this is just saying where is UG not J holomorphic, it was a splicing together of this holomorphic guy and a trivial cylinder. So the only place it could, it might not be J holomorphic is in this green part, the part where we spliced. Now we just use the exponential convergence of UG to a trivial cylinder, and the fact that delta is less than this delta gamma. So we have a weighting function, which is e to the s delta, but this difference that we cut off decays by even faster exponential since delta is less than delta gamma. And then the second part for this part is just the statement that QV prime of CG J0 approaches the descent of this QV prime in C0 J0 just because as G goes to 0, because these sections are continuous. So there's some calculation to do, but this is so the other thing we really, that sort of the other key part of understanding the zero set of FG of 0 near C comma Y equals 0 is the following quadratic estimates. And what this should be really thought of as a uniform bound on this modulus of smoothness of FG. Something basically saying F is in, like, say, F is like a C3 map from this Banach space to this Banach space. And moreover, we're giving an effective bound on its C3 norm independent of G. Okay, now we actually don't need it to be C3. We need something considerably weaker. And what we need is this. So proposition for so we take the derivative, and the derivative at 0 is close to the norm of the derivative at 0 minus the derivative at zeta is bounded by a constant times zeta. So it's some statement which is very similar to saying that the derivative is uniformly Lipschitz. This is for k. So at least 4 C. Okay, this K equals at least 4 condition is really only needed when you have the thickening terms, intersection with divisors. For this guy, it's, you know, this should be true for any K. Okay, so I won't prove this here. Great. So now we come to the part which has somehow most a lot of the content. So this is to construct a bounded right inverse. So let dg denote this derivative of fg at 0.
if G prime is the derivative in the direction of the first one?
In the direction of the second argument. Yes. Oh, sorry. This is terrible notation. Zeta and over here, zeta and xi are both elements of this direct sum.
Oh, they used to be elements. So on the left, xi is only a.
Yeah, so this notation here and the definition and this notation are different. Zero is an element of, is really zero comma zero. Xi is really xi comma y. Zeta is zeta comma y prime. Right, so this is the derivative of f at 0 comma 0, this operator. So it's a linear map from the source to the target, namely given by the derivative of fg at 0. So that's dg. So by assumption, d0 is surjective. So we want to show that dg is also surjective. Okay, we actually want to show a bit more. We want to show that we want to, out of a right inverse for d0, we're going to construct a right inverse for dg. And it'll have two key properties. One is that so in fact, given this right inverse for d0, we will construct a QG with which is a right inverse for G, such that QG sort of uniformly bounded, independent of G. And somehow the image of QG, I'll just put this in quotation marks, varies continuously in G. So I'll say precisely in what sense it varies continuously in G, but I mean, it's these spaces don't like vary nicely in terms of G. So it's not really, there's not a well-defined, there's not an obvious notion of varies continuously, but so I need to say what I mean by that precisely later. Right, so this construction is really a sort of hands-on construction. Given a right inverse d0, we simply sort of write down a right inverse for dg. So we have the key diagram is the following. So we look at this c0 C QI and T DI plus J. So this gets parallel transported with WK to delta C0 and the flattened guy again with this will be a map which gluing map, which basically takes a trace down to CG. And finally, will be a calibration map, which takes this and ensures that it satisfies this extra condition at Q E double prime. So pi RDS plus R is 0. Okay, so now we have all these linearized operators. Right, so this again goes by parallel transport. There's a map in the other direction called break. And this is the same. I won't write it again. Calibrate, calibration map. So this is something extra which has to happen for contact homology, which doesn't need to happen when you're gluing just nodes in, say, Gromov-Witten theory or even Hamiltonian for theory. The point is, we need to ensure this condition. Okay, so let me just sketch the definitions of these maps. So defining glue and break. So here we have C0. And here we have CG. So the glue map so the gluing map is supposed to take a section over C0 and give a section over CG. So what is it going to do? We're going to cut off here, cut off, and we cut off here. So these are these other series of complicated operations. So this is going to happen at something like 1/3 S. So in the region where we've already made it a trivial cylinder. And then we sum, like sum. This is glue. It's the sum of the under this map of the cutoff guys. And now the map break is we pull back and we cut off at the center. Cut off at 1/2. So this is, maybe I should, So the way we cut off for the glue map is not really relevant. We just use it in whatever cutoff function we want. The way we cut off for the break map is crucial. These cutoff, so first of all, it has to happen at the center, and second, these cutoff functions have to be symmetric. That is, when you if you break and then sort of take the sum of fibers back down, you should get the same thing. So this cutoff function is 1 minus this cutoff function. Okay, so finally defining calibration map. So here we have a picture of CG. And there's this vector field, which is just constant, but cut off. So we look at this cutoff function. So this is cut off. Chi times ds ug. So here's QE double prime. And so this is a vector field. So calibrate simply adds the correct multiple of C linear multiple of this, so that this condition projection applied to your vector field becomes 0. Now I want to observe that both of these maps, or all three of these maps, actually all the maps in this diagram, are uniformly bounded. For glue and break, well, okay, you can check. For the calibration map, it's important here that delta is positive for this to be uniformly bounded. And it's important that QE double prime is sort of in the exact center of the neck. That is, it's the point with the maximum weight. So this constant vector field here, which is in the kernel of the D operator. Now this constant vector field in the usual norm just has constant norm 1. But that's somehow not the right norm to think of it in. We should think of it in the weighted norm. And in the weighted norm, the norm of this constant vector field looks something like this. It reaches a maximum at, or say normalizes, so the maximum equals 1 in the center of this guy at QE double prime. And then it decays exponentially as we go towards the boundary of the neck. And this is somehow why this is an OK thing to do, cut it off here. Because whatever xi is at QE double prime, it's very small. It's like e to the minus 1/2 capital S delta times the norm of xi. So this thing that we added is actually very small. So this key diagram does not commute, but it almost commutes. And this is basically the property we need to use it to construct this bounded right inverse. So key diagram commutes. Okay, so the statement is the following. So first, for parallel transport, the statement is very simple, simply the commutator of the maps approaches zero in norm. So these are all, would be three statements, and they're all as g goes to zero. The second statement concerns the bottom. This goes to zero. And finally, the statement for the middle square is a little bit complicated because glue and break go in opposite directions. And the statement that you can is both sufficient and can actually be proven is the following. So this norm is little o of 1 times the norm of eta, where break applied to eta is equal to d 0 g c. Okay, I should comment that in lots of treatments of gluing, this sort of the two upper squares here are sort of combined into one. It's very common to not consider this flattening U0 bar G. But I think it's a good sort of intermediate part and sort of divides your estimate into two constituent pieces, which are sort of different. It's also very important that all this cutting off is happening in the region where U0G is a trivial cylinder, which makes the estimates much, doesn't make them all that much easier, but there's sort of less to worry about.
So it is quantifier on eta, yet it's for all eta such as break is, or for some eta?
For all. Yeah, so how does it work? So xi lies here, and eta lies here. And they get mapped to the same thing here. And the statement is that when you take eta this way, when you take xi this way, they map to the same thing here. And then the statement is that when you take xi around this way, it's very close. Sort of a strange sounding statement, but I don't know any other formulation which is both correct and simpler to state. I mean, you could ask that going this way and going this way are really close, but that's not true. Or either it's not true or it's not enough to show what we want. One of the two, I forget which. Okay, so do I have time? Okay, so maybe I'll just say in words why this is true. I mean, one can do some sort of explicit calculation. For this, the point is again just U0 decays exponentially to a trivial cylinder, and right, these only really differ over the part where you cut off U0 to a trivial cylinder. And over that part, we have this estimate that U0 approaches a trivial cylinder at least sort of exponentially with any delta strictly less than delta gamma. And our chosen delta is less than delta gamma, so we have this estimate. For the calibration one, the point is just that this vector field dsug is in the kernel of the linearized operator. It just corresponds to translating the trivial cylinder or rotating the trivial cylinder. We cut it off. But the point is that cutoff happened really far away from QG. And so the norm, the sort of, when you use the product rule to expand this, this term is very small. There, again, like e to the minus something times delta. So it's crucial that delta is positive for this. Okay, finally, this one. Finally, this one. Maybe I'll just not say why this is true. I mean, you can sort of explicitly analyze what's going on. The point is somehow that the weight, the key point is somehow to compare weights. On C0, you have weights which look like this, and on CG, you have weights which look like this. And the error term in this difference turns out to be something sort of supported here in this type of region. But the norm you care about is this norm, and you have a bound on its norm in this norm. And so the fact that the ratio between these two norms is very small, and so it goes to zero as g goes to zero. So. Okay, so now let's just define these bounded right inverses. So what do I mean varying continuously in G? This is sort of very, very crucial for the gluing map to be continuous in G. This image really has to vary continuously in G. This is and this is somehow a non-trivial statement because the space of gluing parameters could look something like this, and you know, continuity sort of for this gluing parameter and this gluing parameter is some non-trivial statement. So what do I mean continuous in G? So we'll just fix some linear map from this source WK P delta to some vector space given by like evaluating at some points. So for any subspace B, such that the L0 restricted to the kernel of D0 is an isomorphism. So you pick some points and look at this evaluation map. So first you pick some points, so this evaluation map is injective on the kernel. The kernel is finite dimensional, so you can certainly do this. Just pick some points on the domain C0 such that this is, and J is finite dimensional. You can do this. And then quotient out by a suitable subspace B, so it's an isomorphism. So this, of course, gives us a corresponding map LG on this sort of domain of FG. Let me not write it again. It's just this. Okay. Now, we're going to fix fix Q0 which is the right inverse. So D0, Q0 is the identity, and the image of Q0 is the kernel of L0. So since L0 restricted to the kernel of D0 is an isomorphism, the kernel of L0 is a complement for the kernel of D0. And given a choice of complement, the choice of complement determines uniquely a choice of bounded right inverse. Closed complement. This is continuous map, so it's a closed subspace. So then this this lemma implies, this lemma on the key diagram implies that this guy, so TG, which by definition is calibration composed with gluing, composed with parallel transport, composed with Q0, parallel transport, and braking, is an approximate right inverse for DG, meaning that this difference DG TG minus the identity is less than 1. In fact, it goes to 0 as G goes to 0. Right, so what happens? We fix our right inverse here, Q0, and then we define our approximate right inverse by just going around. And that's T, G. And this, of course, if the diagram commuted on the nose, this would be a true right inverse. This approximate commutativity gives us that it's an approximate right inverse. And now, we can use the standard geometric series to invert this. Thus we get true right inverse QG with the same image. Now, by construction, the image of TG is contained in the kernel of LG. This basically just follows by definition. We pass through some map. We apply Q0, and we land in the kernel of L0. And if we look at the definition of parallel transport, glue, and calibration, they're somehow only happening on the necks. And these evaluation points, at least for sufficiently small g, are not in the necks. So this map, this vertical composition, commutes with the L map. So this is our conclusion. Right now, an index calculation shows that this is an isomorphism. So one can calculate the index of dg, and it will be the same as d0. So one concludes that this is an equality. Calculation. I guess really sort of combined with this. Right, we also get a kernel pre-gluing map, a kernel gluing isomorphism from kernel D0 to the kernel of DG, just given by simply applying these maps and then taking the projection onto the kernel induced by this particular choice of right inverse. So this is just projection off of kernel LG. Okay, so now, finally, we can define the gluing map, which gives us what we want. So the bounded right inverse QG determines a local diffeomorphism between the kernel of DG and the inverse image of zero. So this is basically the implicit function theorem. Okay, implicitly, I'm also, of course, using, I mean, crucially in here goes the estimate on the norm of FG of zero, and the boundedness of this right inverse, and the quadratic estimates. So the picture is like this. You have kernel DG. The image of QG, this is the complement. And there's some manifold here, which is FG inverse of zero. And the map here is just projection off of image QG. So this is the map. And this gives a local diffeomorphism. Right. So, and moreover, this is valid in a ball of some fixed size independent of G. And that's where the boundedness is important. So combining these, combining for different values of G, we get this map from RE cross kernel of D0 to M bar X, using our chosen isomorphisms of the kernels. Okay, so now, claim this map is one continuous to injective, meaning its restriction to some neighborhood of zero is injective, and surjective, meaning, so surjective means that for a germ means that for every neighborhood of zero in the source, there exists a neighborhood of x0 in the target, which is covered by this map restricted to the neighborhood in the source. Okay, so these three properties taken together implies it's a local homeomorphism, since the source is locally compact Hausdorff space. So what is the content here? Surjectivity is the content here is using these key a priori estimates of Hofer-Rosatsky Zender about necks, which are C0 close to trivial cylinders. Injectivity essentially follows from the definition of this stuff I was talking about, gauge fixing, at the beginning. In continuity, the content is that, well, somehow this image of QG varies continuously. And what I mean by that is just the image of QG is given by the kernel of this map LG, which, I don't know, however you define varies continuously, it certainly should be satisfied by this evaluation at points map. The content here basically is that we have this map from kernel DG to we have this kernel gluing map from kernel D0 to kernel DG, and this commutes. And the image is the same. And image QG equals kernel LG. So this finishes the proof. Thanks for coming.